So if there is one word for me to characterize Borisov Schroeder, this is superioritism. I looked for Google to check for synonym, and it gave me suprematism, referring to Kazimierz Malevich. And this somehow provoked me to some studies related to the statistics of these meetings. So it's very common now to show photo of people to whom we are referring during the talk. I never did it before. So since there are so many relative names and faces, that I decided to unify, to merge them in one photo. So you guess what it is. So Malevich, black square. Well, you know, Kazimir helped us to enter the object in itself is meaningless. Let's see, is it true? So we go to limited unification, merging of photos of all co-authors of Boris. Again, Malevich, red square. Slightly more optimistic, but still rather featureless. The ideas of the conscious mind are worthless, so don't worry. Well, so in search of reality, now I'm merging all Boris photos which have appeared during this presentation. There are many dozens of them, and again, they merge to something not very relatively featureless. Well, you know, maybe it's a bit ambiguous, but once again, Malevich helped us to come that every reason to view both the mask and the actual face with skepticism, since it disputes the reality of the human faces altogether. Well, I go on. So now we have to apply some filter, at least trying to extract some information. So I'm trying the filter of the first achievements. So we have something else, believe or not, but Malevich called this picture self-portrait in two dimensions, quite relative to our topics. And indeed, we see a lot of things. We see apparent 2D localization. We see self-destructive interference. We have apparently at least single mesoscopic flutation. So Malevich's black circle probably hides a hologram of Borisov Schroeder inventions. Well, it looks so. Well, so maybe back to the black square, now applying the filter of most sincere wishes, which can be given to Boris. So we will see the square to rectangle symmetry breaking, today is called nematicity, and color symmetry violation yields. Best wishes, Boris, and thanks for giving the intensity for all of us to get together. Thank you. So this relatively long introduction was most prestigious present I could give, because nothing is more precious than the time of left for taken from the presentation. So what I'm going to tell today is some recent work after the collaboration with Natasha Kirova, with Insensitive, after our visit to Tokyo. More precisely, this is not quite finished work, even if we are at a deadline to write for another anniversary for Keldysh 85 years. We will see who will be writing for Boris 85 years. It will be JTP Boris, or will it be a GTP when people will write for you 85 years? No? So hence, because of Keldysh, there will be about excitonic insulator, but the condensation of excitons with the path polaritons will provide me to legitimacy to speak at these meetings. So all that will be about the science which exists from the beginning of this millennium or century, like, and this is a science of so-called pump-induced phase transitions. It is related to a bit more old techniques of pump and probe in optics, which, because of particular astonishing progress, is now called the femtosecond pump and probe, where people use very short laser, very short pulses to pump up incredible number of excitations, more than 10% sometimes, maybe up to 50 at the first femtoseconds. And then after this pumping, people see for the evolution. Evolution is obtained by optics, and now remarkably more complicated techniques like angle resolve for the emission, diffraction also becomes time resolved, shorter than picoseconds. And the goal and advantages of this science is, first of all, to disentangle very short electronic times from slow 10 to minus 12 picosecond latest times, which is particularly important for physics of high TC superconductors and for the mode physics. Then provoke dynamic evolution over the wide range of the whole phase diagram, not only near this or those equilibrium states. And then in the course of this evolution, we may either reach the short-living hidden H states, which are unavailable in thermodynamic approaches, which is what they call hidden, or even what there is a recent, very recent success to obtain a truly stable H state with unlimited, at least at low temperature, lifetime. So what is going on? Usually we have a laser, and usually the laser produces us high energy electron and hole pairs, which relax remarkably fast, intense up to 100 femtosecond. So they come to the bottleneck, which means whatever we're interested in, it may be gap, observe the gap in superconductors, in charge density wave, in most insulators, and so on. And since that moment, relatively slow evolution becomes which we trace. I will speak a bit about that, give you one example of this electron hole pumping, but mostly my talk will be about very rare opportunity till now. This is a pumping not to the high energy electron hole pair, but to their bound pairs, which are the excitons. And this is kind of abstract of this original part of the work is that we at high density and cooled excitons might, with a big question mark, form to both theory and experiment, form a quasi condensate, like it is proved for polaritons, a special form of excitons. Now, the wave function psi of this microscopic quantum states will evolve, interacting with other degrees of freedom. We have a system with a typically symmetry broken state, so it interacts with other degrees of freedom, which are themselves prone to instability. And then because of this interaction, a number of things happen. One of them is this psi is subject to self-trapping, akin to self-focusing of light. And also the local intense density can trigger phase transformation even if the mean density is below the global threshold. This is not all what I'm going to say, but now let's go. So actually I have been baptized half a decade ago to this field, very, very close from here. My Jordan River is only one hour drive in Slovenia, in Ljubljana. In principle, this extremely advanced science, it almost totally monopolized by Germany and Japan, with some special facilities in Stanford in the United States. But there is a group in Ljubljana, in such a small country, which actually in some of respects superior to, at least in terms of originality, to many other things. And altogether, we have done a lot, altogether, I mean, some participation from me as a theorist. We have already some four articles published in Nature and Science type of journal of journals, and these are in the title. There are some keywords like coherent dynamics, dynamical symmetry breaking transition, ultra fast switching to stable hidden quantum states, metastable hidden quantum states, and switching between microscopic charge ordering quantum state, now not only by the optics but also by charge injection. And I will speak a bit about only one of them, my earliest and beloved work. So what is going on? Suppose that we are dealing with something, actually this was example of charge density wave. It could be a superconductor. We have a system which has spontaneous symmetry breaking, so it has some degeneracy. Actually, this is a cross-section of the Mexican head potential, if the other parameter is complex. So originally the system was in the symmetry broken state. Then we applied the last laser pulse, electronic temperature becomes very high, and this minimum, this enormous minimum in energy disappears. The minimum now is at the trivial state, or the parameter is zero, like in high temperatures. But the system is prepared at high energy, so it starts to oscillate across the whole interval of the other parameter, and it oscillates. Meanwhile, the electronic temperature decreases, particles recombine, so the new minimum starts to reappear, and then at some moment, this oscillation bump into the barrier, and the system is trapped again. This is a dynamic phase transition. And actually, depending on odd or even number of half oscillations that the system may do, it may end up either in this state or in another state. And it gives also interesting aspect of inhomogeneity, because the system is inhomogeneous, particularly in these experiments, the light intensity of light is different across in depth of the sample. So the system at different parts of the sample may have either different parity number of oscillations. So it may be either in one state or another state. So the domain walls appear. And these domain walls, they annihilate in time. And then we have a theory, rather elementary theory, and the modeling. And this is, I think, from my point of view, it's quite interesting, encouraging comparison between the theory and the experiment. So what we have here appearance of this amplitude mode of the order parameter. This is actually this kind of modeling of the Higgs boson. And then we have the dynamic phase transitions. And later we have some more anomalies, and these anomalies are earthquakes coming from annihilation of domain walls. So this is a short introduction to the cases of electronic pumping. And now to my main goal, pumping to the excitons. By now, this is only one example, but extremely intensively studied. A number of examples is numerous, because practically any system close to the phase transition, which is non-metallic, have some excitons to which we may pump. And these are so-called neutral ionic phase transitions, which happen in the donor accepted chains. And this donor accepted chain has a double phase transition. The first order to phase transition where two order parameters appear. One is not symmetry breaking. This is that the charge transfer, which already is present because these molecules are different, the charge transfer jump from one value to another one, we call it from neutral to pseudo-neutral to pseudo-ionic state. This is effect of strong correlations, because actually it happens only because the system molecules, the correlation molecules are such that it prefers single electron. Molecule wants to have spin 1/2. And then, since somehow these states, even if we have not reached them, but somehow system already knows that it's going towards chain of spin 1/2, it also offers us the spin pair transition, the dimerization instability. And this is symmetry breaking instability. So we have this double instability in our system. So this is more or less the sketch. And what is wonderful that this material offers us two types of excitons. One is the intramolecular excitons at a very high energy. This is its shape, and this is the probe. For example, we may probe, but we also may pump. There are experiments with both pumping to these excitons. And then there is a charge transfer exciton, which, okay, this chemistry-oriented science, called molecular science, calls charge transfer. For us, this is more Vanier mode exciton, the bound state of the electron and hole. They are rather broad, so they have pretty small effective mass. So they are just maybe quite collective particles. So the laser may pump. This is a laser profile. This profile of the exciton. So this is, we can write an elementary modeling. This is exciton energy multiplied with concentration plus repulsion of excitons, plus we will need it the interaction of the third order of three excitons. And here we have the dimerization, and this dimerization coefficient to R squared changes when Q exceeds some critical value. So when the charge, if the charge transfer by pumping of some evolution exceeds QC, then we have also the symmetry breaking transition. So we have a kind of I. So we have trivial minimum, and we have the minimum at final Q more than QC, and two opposite values of H of dimerization. And this is the energy profile and the derivative of the energy over the concentration Q. So a kind of V is a kind of chemical potential of exciton. And instantaneous energy of excitons. So we see four intervals, repulsion of excitons. Then we have attraction of excitons. Then we have the region of absolute instability of negative energy of excitons, where they will be spontaneously created. And then again, this table. So I have maybe original phase, which is a quasi-neutral phase. Another stable phase is this quasi-ionic state. Well, so now we are discussing the thing. So charge transfer excitons pump in a media prone to also charge transfer instability. So it means actually that both the exciton and the charge ordering are built from the same processes of electron transfer between donors and molecules. So the thermodynamic order parameter and intensity of pump excitons are of the same origin. And let me just literally call them call them undistinguishable. Okay, so I have not distinguishing from the thermodynamic or the parameter. So how can we treat it altogether? Both the excitons pumping, which probably by the condensation, and the thermodynamic phase transition. It can be done, maybe the only way, at least most efficient way, recalling the very old concepts of excitonic insulator introduced by a number of people in the 60s. More recently, it is called quite frequently in interpretation of experiments and some theory appears. So actually, what this theory tells literally in application of semiconductors, conventional semiconductors, is that suppose I have the particle gap EG, I have the bonding energy of the electron, and then since they can be manipulated by pressure by some other field independently, why not EB to become as large so that the total energy of exciton becomes negative? So at that time it was very exotic thing, and I'm not sure that it really exists in the conventional semiconductors. But we understand today that there is nothing but a quantum phase transition, a kind of quantum phase transition. At zero temperature, energy of some excitation becomes zero. Well, this concept is too general for us. It covers practically all, at least non-metallic quantum phase transitions. So we distinguish it in a way that it was originally suggested for semiconductors when the total number of excitons is approximately conserved. Not exactly, but at least changes slowly. And then just recall that microscopic theories, if we recall the theories of Keldysh-Kapayev, of Kohn with Jerome and Rice and other people who actually gave this nickname excitonic insulator, then these two theories of pump excitons and the theories of excitonic insulator, they are theoretically almost the same, just we have different control parameters, either chemical potential or the concentration. And that will help us to build the theory. Now, we face immediately some interesting question, this enigma, because thermodynamic charge transfer, the distribution of charge density, is a single, generally speaking, non-conserved field. And if I decide phenomenologically to write some equation of motion guiding the dynamics of the system, I would just write something with second derivative of Q is variation of the omega over Q. And this is Q is not conserved, so Q may move as much as we see, just as we saw in the first example of charge density wave, which I showed in the beginning. But now if I'm saying that this Q is modulo psi squared, then modulo psi will be, naturally we will see it, will be described by another first order differential equation, which is a kind of generalized Gross-Pitayevsky equation, and it conserves the number of particles. So it means that within this theory, I will not be able to change the number of excitons at all, so I will not be able to change dynamically the other parameter. When I do thermodynamics, I don't care about the times. Time is infinite. The system will always pass, find some path. But in dynamics, I will not see this path. Now, the resolution actually exists if we notice one quite passing by work of Keldysh and Kozlov in the end of the hot stories of excitonic insulator, and they notice the following thing. When I decompose my particles in the semiconductor, the wave function operator in terms of electrons and holes, and write the original total Coulomb interaction, I find not only direct scattering like electron goes to electron, holes and holes, so which actually after I declare this thing to be average in the face of the excitonic insulator or Bose condensate, that will give me psi, that will give me psi star. There are also some other processes which do not conserve the number of particles. Because here, two electrons go to two holes. Normally, these are virtual processes. They don't conserve the energy. But if the system has a condensate, then they give me immediately psi squared plus psi star squared. Certainly, there is some phase, but I will consider it to be zero. So I have, and this is the source for non-conservation of a number of particles. Recall that, when Valery Pokrovsky a few days ago spoke about theory of spin waves or of Bose condensation in magnons, he also noticed and played with these terms which do not conserve the total number of magnons. Well. So what I will have now the generalized Gross-Pitayevsky equation, in which sense generalized, because Hamiltonian will be variation, it may not be just simple psi to the fourth, not originate from simple repulsion, psi to the fourth, it's a variation of Q over the total energy, which concerns also interaction with other parameters. And this psi star is coming from non-conservation, from the generation of pairs of electrons from vacuum, pairs of excitons from the vacuum. Now we have gamma here. Well, this is attenuation parameter, and in the theory of polariton that Natasha Berloff reported here today, actually it appears it's important and well discussed quantity. But what we know about that? So certainly we know that gamma is, we need now is in wide interval as a function of Q. Well, in principle, there is a finite lifetime of single exciton, but for me, vanishing concentration will be still a macroscopic concentration. So gamma will be where it is. Gamma will be proportional to Q. This is just spontaneous. Because of the Bose statistics. But what is important, I claim that actually when we reach the minimum here, there is no channel to decay once again. So gamma must become here zero. So if I would work without this particular term, I would write the gamma is proportional to V. V is the derivative of the energy curve. So it is zero in the static phase, which cannot the very complicated multi-particle process, because certainly metastable state should decay somehow, but it's not, that doesn't decay in a simple way. Gamma, yes, I claim that the gamma should vanish here, yes. No, here gamma proportional to Q. Actually, there will be some finite value for gamma because even the single exciton can decay. But for me, small Q equals tending to zero is still a macroscopic concentration of exciton. So I write this spontaneous emission. Okay, but then actually this minimum is more complicated because we live not only in the amplitude Q but also in the phase now. So my claim is that actually this condition is generalized as that this gamma will be proportional d phi over dt. So when there is no more time dependence, then no more decay. The system reached thermodynamic stable state. So if I now write it in I will not speak much about space dependence. So suppose I'm in a kind of quantum dot or enforce the homogeneous regime, which is not quite so. And then I have a system of couple equations. Now if I actually there is also dummy dependence on this another symmetry breaking parameter for which I have another equation. Well, so this term gives me either if I'm very close somehow, weak, very close to zero, I'm close to metastable state, then it gives me locking of the phase. If not, it gives me oscillations. So now let me do the following thing. Let me make the Toyn model for simplicity, where I do not have this lattice dimerization. So because lattice dimerization brings because of its frequency, it will bring its own oscillations. So what we see here, I had here in the beginning, I had the excitonic insulator. I pump it, I deviated from the equilibrium. And since I pump it with Q exceeding the lock-in transition, then for a while my phase goes almost linearly. It means that I have a given energy of elementary excitation. Phi dot, the time derivative of phase is the energy, so I have the energy. But then I have a lock in. So this more or less the phase space, the plot, polar plot, Q as function of P. We see how we go from one regime, unlocked regime, to the locked one. Well, so once again the generic model. So now I'm just above the threshold transition. So I have a long waiting time because I put myself close to the threshold, but after the threshold, we see that the system, so original system was instead Q equals zero. So it was neutral phase. And here final Q is the excitonic insulator state. So originally I was Q zero, then I pumped it. I pump it up to this level, which is slightly supercritical. The system stays here, and then it loses. It has very, very strong oscillations until it experiences the dynamic phase transition to another phase. And now let me go to more complicated picture, actually the real picture for this material. When I have also the lattice, and the lattice has its own oscillations. So here S equals zero, so I don't have here any oscillation, which I have said before, from microscopic interference. For small s, so what happens, I have a dynamic phase transition. Phase is more or less goes linearly in time, so I'm in the state with the given energy of exciton. Actually, this is the time derivative. I see some oscillations, and then since I'm at subcritical pumping, in spite of some strong initial oscillations, Q finally wanes. So my exciton disappear. Now almost the same from if I introduce S, but only oscillations appear. I have this quantum interference between the Bose condensate of excitons and the ground state of the excitonic insulator. And then I go to the supercritical pumping. If I am at short time scale, I see that okay in the beginning Q decreases, but not sufficiently. Then it is picked up, and the exciton energy somehow starts to oscillate between positive and negative parts. So in this part excitons are emitted from the vacuum. Here exciton is negative. They are emitted from the vacuum. And we see some tendency of the phase in the original phi dot. It was more or less given energy of the exciton, and now it tends to level to zero. So then finally, maybe the last at long times, what we have now, if there is no this Keldysh term, no phase locking terms, then the system will grow gradually come. We are at the supercritical pumping to the new state. This is an equilibrium, metastable equilibrium state of the excitonic insulator, and the exciton, the phase is finally locked, we pass through the energy, through the region of negative, positive excitonic energy to unstable region of the negative, of negative excitonic energies, and then again back to the stability. And, but it's locked at arbitrary value. The drug may be depend on the initial condition and so on, but as soon as I introduce at least small phase locking term, then instead of this smooth transition here, I have abrupt locking transition, which generates for me new series of excitations. Well, so it was more or less conditional that. I impose more or less homogeneous conditions, so at least the sample is not too big. Now, what happens if I take into account some initial fluctuations? So now this is modeling not only in time but in time and space. And what I do recall that the latest dimerization was a symmetry breaking parameter because it can have either positive or negative values. So we introduce here the extremely small 10^-12. Initial perturbation of different sites in two halves of the sample. Actually, it will be better to study disordered systems, but it has not been done yet. And then we see that the two domains appear, one with opposite equivalent signs, and then one of them wins, another vanishes. And then the one which wins, if attenuation is small, it starts to make oscillations around the middle of the sample. If I'm close to the end, yeah. Okay, I'm very close. So I have not spoken here at all about the case, which is slightly more complicated because we have more fields, but conceptually much more simple. The case I have mentioned of so-called intramolecular excitons, where the excitonic density and the order parameter are different fields. So we just simply now without much philosophy write and solve the coupled system of equations. So we see here some a number of interesting things which we have done here for so at short times we see origination of the there is no seeding here anymore, no seeding for the symmetry breaking, so the system itself experiences the self focusing and then in two different points and then they merge, they start to oscillate, and this is even before the dimerization appears. It's a moment maybe because of merging of different domains the amplitude becomes sufficiently large to provoke the symmetry breaking phase transitions, and if I go now to high times, then with time now the concentration of excitons may even disappear, but the system keeps the persistent domain. So it's practically all what I wanted to say. So one cannot witness against himself, at least without presence of the advocate. But still, I want to say that what about some regrets and cues about some suggestions or incomplete studies that we have done. Thank you.
Thank you very much.